have some visitors with us, and we're proud that they saw fit to come our way. Let's don't forget about Dawn, Mary, and Patton now. They are kind of there in the house, and we need to keep a check on them, make sure that they've got everything that they need. Darnell, too. Darnell had to go back to the doctor early this morning. Let's remember her so she can get that situation hopefully rectified quickly. Also, we got a lot going on. We've got some of our teenagers who are talking to some of their teenage friends about certain things, some heavy things, dealing with family and life and everything. And so we need to pray for our teens as they help some of their friends. And you never know, you know, the 50 and wise are going out on Wednesday evening. We made some contacts too. Maybe we can try to talk some folks into visiting with us here at Skyline. You never can tell. Each age group, I think, has got a lot going on. You know, too, let's don't forget about the family of the man who was killed in that robbery at the Minimark here too close. Terrible, terrible situation there. I guess that kind of hits home because I was raised in a small store, a little mini mart as well, if you want to call it like that. You know, it's just a bad situation within our society where people have no respect for human life at all. And we need to remember our community as well as remember our nation with so much going on. Also, I tell you what, I've been on the phone quite a bit with all the good well wishes for my birthday. You know, you get up as old as I am, you welcome any contact from anybody. Lots of cards, begging a banana pudding, Octavia, my favorite pound cake, and I mean, we just had lots to eat. Donuts, appreciate it, Sonia. All of that and all of the food we had Thursday night. It was just a great celebration for me, and I appreciate that so much. On August the 17th, 1790, the leader of the Hebrew congregation in Newport, Rhode Island, penned a letter to George Washington welcoming the newly elected president to Rhode Island. The Jewish people told him how high in esteem that they held him, and they thanked the God of Israel there who had protected King David for also protecting General Washington and now President Washington during the Revolutionary War there. Now the response that President Washington gave, I think, was very presidential. And while not meaning to, President Washington might have given them an evangelistic message. I don't know whether they caught it or not, but I think it's in here. Whether he meant to or not, I think it's in here. Listen as what Washington said. It said, "It would be inconsistent with the frankness of my character not to avow that I am pleased with your favorable opinion of my administration and fervent wishes for my good health. May the children of the stock of Abraham who dwell in this land continue to merit and enjoy the goodwill of the other inhabitants, while everyone shall sit in safety under his own vine and fig tree, and there shall be none to make him afraid. May the Father of all mercies scatter light and not darkness in our paths and make us all in our several vocations useful here and in his own due time and way everlastingly happy." Now, I've always stood amazed at the usage of the English language which our founding fathers had. And I stand amazed in their willingness to publicly proclaim their belief in the Creator God, who Washington here identifies, let's see, as the Father of all mercies. Now, of course, our prayer this morning should be that our leaders also pray to the Father of all mercies and the Father of light, that our God is called so often. However, one phrase there that piqued my interest in this letter was Washington's own personal wish that, now listen now, each inhabitant of this nation be able to sit in safety under his own vine and fig tree. Now, you might not recognize this verse, but this verse Cooper read for us just a little while ago. Washington borrowed it from Micah 4, 1 through 4, where Micah 4 again says, "But everyone shall sit under his vine and his fig tree, and no one shall make them afraid." Now, this is the verse that Washington quoted. Now, no doubt after this long Revolutionary War, after General Washington led the troops, after he was chased, you know, during the war, I'm sure all the British forces were trying to catch and find him. But whether he's talking about the safety and rest after the long war, or he's talking about maybe a little bit deeper meaning, when we take verses Micah 4, 1 through 3 into account, Washington may be talking about something else. Because those verses that Cooper read directs the reader to the establishment of the church and the coming of Jesus Christ. And Micah 4 then says, may we rest under the safety of our own vine and fig tree. Now, whether President Washington had any deeper intended meaning, more meaning, let's say, than resting safely under his vine and his fig tree, meaning no war, no battles, no fear, no destruction. Whether he means that or, hey, folks, you as within this particular religion should be looking forward to the coming of Jesus Christ and the establishment of the church. I'm not sure, but this is a very interesting verse and it's a very interesting letter here that President Washington had written back to them. I know I haven't given much thought to that particular phrase. This phrase is also found in 1 Kings 4:24, where we read, "And Judah and Israel dwelt safely," listen now, "each man under his vine and his fig tree, from Dan as far as Beersheba, all the days of Solomon." Each man sitting under his vine and his fig tree, within this verse certainly carries with it the idea of peace and security. No hostilities. Certainly does that. But in thinking about the idea of peace within the nation, we might conclude that Washington is talking about sitting on the porch of Mount Vernon, and I don't know whether any of y'all have been up there. I'm sure many of you have. It's a beautiful place out there, and I love going out there on that porch overlooking the river. And whether Washington is talking about sitting out there enjoying peace and prosperity, or whether he's talking about a little bit more, I'm not sure. But Washington knew the scripture enough to pull from that particular verse. And that particular verse is the end to three verses that talk about the coming of the end of the Jewish age, okay, and the beginning of the Christian age. Now, in preparing for this lesson, it became obvious to me that I just did not pay much attention to the fig. I've just not given the fig its rightful due. Tina, I just hadn't done it. I'm sorry. Now, the role that the fig to just call it the mighty fig. Have to. Have to. It's a very important fruit within the Bible, and it's used quite often. And if we talk it up, Luke, we might be able to get us a mascot here. Skyline. The mighty fighting figs. Now y'all got to laugh a little bit now. I'm trying to wake you up here. I'm trying to, you know. The fighting figs. It's got a certain ring to it. And I know I haven't given the fig, you know, its rightful due. And I love figs. My mother had a big fig tree that produced lots of figs. Remember the church in Greenwood had a beautiful fig tree that produced lots of figs. Just this past week, Tina gave me some strawberry fig preserves and some regular fig preserves. And I've been attacking those jars this past week. A couple of years ago, my youngest grandson there in Amory wanted to plant some fruit trees. So we planted some 30 fruit trees around the place, and four of those were brown turkey figs. So, you know, hopefully we'll have some figs here pretty soon. Maybe I won't die, Lord willing, before some of those trees start producing. But anyway, the fig trees there in the Bible, I'm told, you know, we grow to like 20 feet tall, and they've got a big fig leaf there on it. And everyone wanted their own vines and fig trees because of the produce, which was very valuable. First mention of a fig tree within the Bible was in Genesis 3:7, where the reference was made to the leaves that Adam and Eve sewed together. And Wednesday night, thought I'd have to stop Brad. Brad's going to get into my lesson today when he talked about that. Brad and I sometimes on Wednesday night, he'll say something about my lesson on Sunday morning. I don't, you know, wise minds think alike, Brad. That's just the way it is. But anyway, you know, I don't know about them clothes made out of fig leaves, but y'all ever been up in the middle of a fig tree before? It could be rough. But anyway, Adam and Eve sewed them fig leaves together some way to make some clothes. Figs are mentioned there too in Deuteronomy 8:8 as part of abundant produce, okay, of the land of Canaan that God would give to Israel. Numbers 13:23, these figs were part of the samples of the fruit that the spies brought back from the land. Jeremiah 24:2, we find a fig being used in describing the obedience of Israel being a good fig and the disobedience of Israel being an evil or bad fig or bad fruit. There are 22 other verses regarding figs in 14 different books in the Bible. In Luke 13:6, we have the parable of the barren fig tree. We know about that, where a landowner, his fig tree just wasn't producing. And he got frustrated. And since the fig tree wasn't producing, he said, I'm going to cut it back. But the vinekeeper said, hey, let me work with this fig tree a little bit. Let me put some fertilizer around it. Let me kind of till around it. Let me kind of prune it up, take care of it, you know, and let's see if I can get some fruit growing on it. Okay, I'll let you do that. And you know, this parable, if we think about it, could be very, very meaningful to us as well if we think about this thing. Because you see, we might be able just to see ourselves in this barren fig tree here. Are we producing any fruit? Are we doing any good at all for the kingdom, for God, for each other, for the church? Or are we just some sticks growing up there? Nothing at all to show for our love for God. What about it? What about it? Could it be that our service to God is non-existent? Could it be that we come to the to services on Sunday morning to be seen of others? Could it be that we come to Sunday morning without the sacrifices that we should offer? Without getting ourselves ready, without getting our thoughts ready and our mind ready to worship God? Could it be that our life for Christ is non-existent? I don't know. I want you to think about it. You just play in church. Could it be that God really wants to cut us down and throw us into the fire, but Jesus is there pleading our case, saying, well, wait, just a minute. Don't let the devil get him now. Don't let the devil get him. Let's let Skyline work on him a little bit. Let's tend to him a little bit. Put a little fertilizer on him. Till up the ground around him. Try to get him to do better. Don't let the devil get him. Could it be that Jesus is pleading our case? Hold off, Lord. Hold off. Give me a little bit more time. He's going to be baptized. She's going to be baptized. He's going to respond to your invitation and obedience. He's going to do it. Just give me a little bit more time. Whatever it is, Jesus is trying, you know, to help us out one way or the other, I think. And I think that's what this parable can tell us if we think about it. Now, the New Testament story of the fig tree that we're most probably familiar with can be found in Matthew 21:18 and Mark 11:12. I'm going to read a little bit there in Mark 11, starting there in verse 12. And on the day when they had departed from Bethany, he became hungry. And this is Jesus. And seeing at a distance a fig tree and leaf, he went to see if perhaps he would find anything on it. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. And he answered and said to it, "May no one ever eat fruit from you again." And his disciples were listening. And they came to Jerusalem, and he entered the temple and began to cast out those who were buying and selling in the temple, and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who were selling doves. And he would not permit anyone to carry goods through the temple. And he began to teach and say to them, Is it not written, my house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations, but you have made it a den of robbers. Jesus and his disciples were walking from Bethany back to Jerusalem one morning. Jesus became hungry. He saw that fig tree. And I love to go and pick ripe figs. I mean, they are so sweet. So good. And no, usually when I do that, I don't wash them. Just eat them. But when he went over there, there were no figs. And he caused the fig tree to die because it had no fruit. Notice here in Mark, he does say it was not the season for figs. At first glance, this might seem, you know, a little harsh of Jesus. But upon closer thinking about this, we must understand that if it was not the season for figs, it shouldn't have been any leaves on it. But the show of the leaves, there should have been some fruit hanging there. But it wasn't. The fig tree basically was kind of fooling everybody. You could see all the leaves there. Oh, well, look at this, man. This is going to be good. You go over there and you kind of pull back the leaves. There's nothing there. Within the Bible, Israel is often referred to as a fig tree. And I don't think we should think of this passage without acknowledging that from that barren tree there, Jesus goes into Jerusalem and he found major problems going on. He turns over again the tables of the money changers and he ran those out that were buying and selling goods there. Again, you see, the fig tree, Israel, had failed to produce the proper fruit. the Passover, the celebration, the crowds, the singing, the offerings, you see, was all for show. Jesus goes up to Jerusalem and he sees all these fig leaves, okay? It's covered. Oh, it's looking good. It's looking good. But when he pulls back the leaves, there's nothing there. What Jesus found was a den of robbers. Lots of leaves, but no fruit. If one should listen to the scribes and the Pharisees and see the hustle and bustle going around at that time in Jerusalem, someone might get the impression that, hey man, a lot of God's work was going on around here. Lots of good things happening. Will of God is getting accomplished. But it wasn't. It wasn't. When one pulls back the fig leaves, nothing's there. You would think that there was a great, deep love for God. But it wasn't. But it wasn't. These individuals were just pretending to have the fruit. Trying to be real religious. Trying to show others how good they were. Standing on pomp and circumstance. They stood in the marketplace and fooled lots of people because of all of the green leaves they had surrounding them. But they didn't fool Jesus. He cursed the barren fig tree, and by extension, he cursed the Pharisees and the scribes and all the people there who thought they were doing the will of God, who thought they were doing things that would make God pleased with them. And he said, "Get out! Get out!" And he cursed the fig tree and the disobedient Jewish people and hypocritical Israelites. But this cursing is not about historical Israel today. It's about us. It's about us individually. We need to look at ourselves. And we made for us a clothing of fig leaves. Have we sewn some fig leaves together, you know, and just put it all around us where it looks like we're producing lots of fruit, or that we have the proper love for God, or that, as John Adam talked about, putting God as a priority within our lives? What's happening? John 15:1, we find Jesus saying, "I am the true vine and my Father is the vine dresser." All right, Jesus teaches here in John 15 the same message, the same idea, and the consequences of not being an obedient child of God. Where there are leaves but no fruit, the same will happen to us. We will be cursed. We will die. No fruit is produced. Branches will be cut off and burned up. It may be that our leaves look like those of an 18 Christian. An overstuffed schedule of religious activities. But as one pulls back the leaves, nothing's there. You know what? We're just hypocritical Pharisees. Are we going to play Christian? Or are we going to really become part of God's team? You put up some leaves, you can fool us, but you're not going to fool God. Rendering obedience to his word. Obeying Jesus in baptism, serving God by serving our fellow man, carry the gospel to the world. The fruit that we produce, God recognizes as obedience to Him. As we close, let's get back to President George for a second. Reconsider there. He says, everyone should sit under his vine and his fig tree. I'm sure that's cool. That feels good. We've all got a place probably at our own homes where we like to get out there under the tree. Again, this comment comes on the heels of the prophecy of the coming of the church there in Micah 4:1. There in Micah it says, in the latter days there, this is going to happen. The latter days always carries with it the meaning of in the time of the Messiah. There in Hebrews 1:2 it says, in these latter days he has spoken to us through his Son. See, this is the time there that Micah's talking about. The mountain of the Lord's house, the place where the Lord speaks from, the New Testament, Mount Sinai. That is, the church will be established in the latter days, and Christ will speak through the church. All nations, Jews and Gentiles, will be welcomed into it. And the word of the Lord will be taught. That is, we will be under the law of Christ. The Jewish age will have come to an end. Once we understand that, once we read and believe in God's word, once we grasp what Jesus has done for us, and then we render obedience to Him, looking forward to the future and looking forward to those promises that He has given us regarding us living with him in heaven. You see, then we will be able to sit under our own vine and our own fig tree in safety and surety. We should worry no more. We should have the hope and the faith that will carry us through the days ahead. Why? Because we know we have obeyed God. We have fruit within our lives. We don't have just leaves surrounding us, and we can sit under our own mighty fig tree. For any reason, we can help you this morning. If you need to be baptized, if you need to come back to God, let us help you there. If for some reason things are bothering you within your life, let us help you this morning. Come forward now while we stand and sing.
Why do you wait, dear brother?
morning from Jeremiah 31, verses 31 through 33. And Jeremiah is telling us about the future of the new covenant that is going to be coming. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant which they broke, although I was a husband to them, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. In Luke 22, verses 19 through 20, Jesus explains the beginning of the new covenant. And he took the bread, he gave thanks, he broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant of my blood, which is shed for you. Jesus is telling us that the new covenant will begin with his death on the cross. And today, we're under that new covenant. We can thank Jesus for being willing to give his life for that new covenant. And under the new covenant, we can have salvation and eternal life in heaven. Today, in just a few moments, we'll remember what Jesus had to do to give us, what he had to do to give us that new covenant with God.
just think of this cup and what it represents. Just please bless this cup, the fruit of the vine, which represents Christ's blood that was shed on that fruit cross Calvary. As we take of it, please help us think back on that day, think back on that great sacrifice that was made, and what it means to us as Christians. And so please help those that take of it now that they're well pleasing in my sight.
Continue to bless us and please forgive us for all our sins and shortcomings.